In New York, within Central Park, you have the Bethesda Terrace. Now, the Bethesda Terrace was originally named the Water Terrace, and indeed to this day, there is a plaque there titled Navy Terrace. Both of those, of course, would represent water. Bethesda would relate to the House of Mercy. My attention came to this part of the world by seeing this photograph and seeing the four around the one, as I term it, in the foreground, where you would have the, plus the concentric circles there, so you would have the four elements around the spirit in the center, kind of making up the pentagram, if you will. You would have the mage in the center, and it would be like perhaps a portal way, an axis mundi, kind of going through the center of that with a kind of etheric shell there also, an etheric magnetic shell. But for a moment, let's look at the fountain in the background. And atop that fountain is the angel of the waters, holding a lily in one hand and blessing the waters with the other hand. Indeed, those waters would be healing waters, and we'll get into that. The lily is also held by the archangel Gabriel, and the archangel Gabriel would relate to the element of water, whereas the other three main archangels would relate to the other elements, earth, air, and fire. But Gabriel relates to water. So the angel has sort of come in, sort of flowing in, if you will, to the top. This is like a pillar in a way in the center here. And indeed, if we go down, so it's on the center of the pillar at the top. And then if we go down a level, there are four cherubs there. Now, each of those cherubs officially represents temperance, purity, health, and peace. But they would also, no doubt, represent one of the four elements plus one of the seasons plus one of the cardinal directions, etc., in the astral sense here. And you have the pillar in the center, which would be Jack's beanstalk in the center right there. Now, this would perhaps be an astral configuration of light represented here in bronze, perhaps. And it's like an axis mundi, if you will, a portal way, like an astral portal way in the center of this fountain. The waters of the fountain would perhaps relate to the checkers, double as the checkers. If we go to Brisbane in Australia for a moment, and you can see a monument there where you have the checkers, but you also have the representation of water around there. Indeed, if we go back to Central Park, not far away from this fountain is Strawberry Fields, and we have the design there on the ground for John Lennon with Magi in the center, imagine in the center there, and of course you have the checkers there. And I would suggest that this kind of doubles in a way, or you could kind of slap this thing over top of the fountain, let's say. Another aspect about the fountain is that the area there supposedly has, and there are owls and birds and foliage and stuff represented there, bats, but there would be iconography around there that would relate to the seasons. Now, that would be the four seasons, also the times of the day and the ages of mankind. So this is definitely alluding to the zodiac. Elsewhere within Central Park, you have the obelisk that was brought in from Egypt, and around the base of that obelisk, you have the crab's claw there, which would relate to the star sign of Cancer. On a yearly basis, the sun transits Cancer beginning around June 21, June 22, and just remember that date. Also to note is that the Archangel Gabriel rules over the star sign of Cancer. Here you can see a Cancer the Crab tattoo, and central to it is a sigil said to be linked to the Archangel Gabriel. Now, these would be like an interdimensional signature, if you will. Here is a further design also said to be linked to the Archangel Gabriel. I think it's interesting to have this link perhaps with the Archangel Gabriel and both the obelisk in a way, and also the fountain on the Bethesda Terrace. So getting back to the fountain commemorates the Croton Aqueduct that was sort of opened up in 1842 on the 22nd of June, on the summer solstice, as it turns out. And that aqueduct went on to supply New York City with fresh, clean water. And this has been said to have averted a possible cholera epidemic. So there's that sort of healing aspect, and this fountain, in a way, kind of ties in with that aspect. Now, the terrace is termed Bethesda, and indeed, this has biblical overtones, and it relates to the Gospel of John, chapter 5, verses 2 to 4, where it talks about the angel coming down and blessing the water and the sick around the pool. If one gets into the water first, then they get healed, and so forth. Where I want to head here is that this pool is supposedly been sort of uncovered in Jerusalem. So you have the pool of Bethesda there. Aside from this, it has been said that Mary was born there. Now, just keep in mind the allegory here of the water relating to magnetism and Mary, etc. Why? Because people tend to take things literally when really the allegory runs much deeper, running into alchemy and running into the practice of magic, the manipulation of etheric matter, etc. Traveling through portals, sending messages through portals, communicating. So you'd have the person as the pillar of light, like the Caryatids. Now, Freemasons tell us that sacred symbols come from other dimensions. And indeed, within the Bible, there are verses that kind of relate to this too. Let's have a look at now, and I'll just read the pertinent parts out of the verses, or this will take too long, regarding people and pillars and chakras and elementals, etc., these sorts of things. The earth and all the inhabitants thereof are dissolved. Now, dissolved to me sounds like alchemy. I bear up the pillars of it. Selah. Now, this verse talks about the Lord being within a pillar and going forth by day in that pillar of cloud and by night in the pillar of fire. He spake unto them in the cloudy pillar. They kept his testimonies, the ordinance that he gave them. And I will shew wonders in the heavens and in the earth, blood and fire and pillars of smoke. Now, notice earth, fire. Now, blood could relate to water, I would suggest, in this case, esoterically, because there's a lot of water and blood. And then you have pillars of smoke. The smoke would perhaps relate to air in a way. So you have earth, water, fire, and air. Earth, air, fire, and water there. I would deeply suspect, esoterically, wisdom has built her house. She has hewn out her seven pillars, seven chakras. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, but the bush was not consumed. So this etheric fire is not burning a physical bush here. And the Lord is speaking out of the flame, like an apparition. And it came to pass that in the morning watch the Lord looked unto the host of Egyptians through the pillar of fire and of the cloud, and troubled the host of the Egyptians. And when James, Cephas, and John, who seemed to be pillars, what is the viewer seeing here? But his wife looked back from behind him, and she became a pillar of salt. Here we have a reference to someone becoming a pillar.
Transforming into a pillar.
Of course, salt is going to relate to alchemy. My heart was hot within me. While I was musing, the fire burned. Then spake I with my tongue. All very interesting. But my heart was hot. You see Jesus with the burning, flaming heart. This relates to the heart chakra. While I was musing, the fire burned. So using his mind to sort of, this is meditation, but also musing on the etheric fire, if you will, that kind of runs through the body. Because the mind is part of this also. The mind is part of the fabrication. And this would be the same for spirits. I would deeply suspect that various spirits kind of fabricate and manifest. For example, I've been told by a Freemason that they actually visualize the wyvern, for example, and this would also no doubt relate to the griffin, etc. There are various texts with information on this phenomenon, and it is astral. So when we look at this image, it best depicts the sort of physical world that you can see versus the astral world and entities that one can see when raised up through the chakras, for example. If we look to Lady Gaga, we can see the lightning strike that we could see in that image shown on Lady Gaga. Within and around Lady Gaga, we can see further imagery, occult on steroids. David Bowie, you can see that lightning strike also, and David Bowie, other imagery to do with the occult. Harry Potter, all occult, you can see the lightning strike there also on the face. Occult, occult, occult. Presenting the astral. And within this, I would suggest that we are seeing consciousnesses that are bringing forth constructions of light and, interestingly enough, perhaps physical manifestations. We can see interesting verses in the Bible. Mind over matter. But now let's look at the edifice of a church. Now, in this case, think of the church as with participants as a ritual area, and you have the pillar going through the church. The church, in a way, is part of that bigger pillar, because you can have the single person in the kind of going up through the chakras themselves, but you can also have the larger edifice of people. So just reading here, if I tarry along, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar. So it's relating the church to a pillar and ground of the truth. Now here we have the number 7 aligned with the pillars, chakras, 7 chakras, and the checker work also. So, and nets of checker work and wreaths of chain work for the chapiters were upon the top of the pillars, 7 for one chapiter and 7 for the other chapiter. And now we have talk of an entity coming down the pillar. So, and the Lord came down in the pillar of the cloud and stood in the door of the tabernacle. So I'll read that again. And the Lord came down in the pillar of the cloud and stood in the door of the tabernacle. Now, this verse relates to King Solomon. So, what is this coming up from the wilderness like columns of smoke, perfumed with myrrh and frankincense? So this is relating the person to a column. And I saw another mighty angel come down from heaven, clothed with a cloud. Interesting, clothed with a cloud, clothing in a cloud of clothing. What is that all about? And a rainbow upon its head. Well, this could really possibly relate to the crown chakra. And his face was, as it were, the sun. The face of the sun? Why is the sun anthropomorphized so often? And his feet are pillars of fire. Now this relates to the lilies and the pillar, because the pillars have foliage, plant foliage going up through them, whether this is like the fasci as well. So they're like the tree of life, and this is perhaps a manifestation by angelic entities as well, a kind of fabrication perhaps. But anyway, the tops of the pillars were shaped like lilies, and upon the top of the pillars was lily work. So was the work of the pillars finished. Now here we're going to have talk of anointing. Then shalt thou take the anointing oil and pour it upon his head and anoint him. So here we're anointing the person. I am the God of Bethel, where thou ointest the pillar, and where thou vowest to vow unto me. So now we are, instead of anointing the person, we are anointing the pillar, which I would suggest is the same thing. The pillars of heaven tremble and are astonished at his reproof. This sounds like people trembling, entities trembling, because they are astonished. Okay, so let's take a little bit of a break from the intensity of repeated Bible verses and look at this fresco within the Visoki Dikani Monastery in Kosovo, where up in the upper corners you can see what some people have regarded as UFOs. I would suggest that they represent spirits within the sun and the moon. If you look at the one to the right hand of Jesus, you can see that it has a yellowness around it representing the sun, whereas the one to the left hand has less light to it, if you will. Now, if we look further down within this very fresco, we can see Jesus within the auric vesica Pisces, and we can see a kind of spikes behind him, which may remind us of what we've just seen with the representation of the sun and the moon, which I suggest are being represented as traveling across the sky. Looking back down to Jesus, and beside Jesus we can see angels. There we can see figures with spirit orbs. They are holding spirit orbs, and they have figures in which are much smaller in scale. And indeed we can see a representation of this, I would suggest, in Dendera in Egypt. We can also see further representations with this smaller scale elsewhere, and I've even come across this on Roman coins.
Powerful people show the symbology.
Indeed, if we look to further artworks, we can see the likeliness with the sun and the spike. We can see likenesses to the Visoki Dikani Monastery fresco with the sun and the moon there. So just have a look at that. Now, another thing we can see within this fresco is we can see that Jesus is on the cross and he would have two nails in his hands. So these would be kind of openings in his hands. I've shown this hand before on a donation box within the Sydney Masonic Centre. And I would suggest that that slot in the hand has the esoteric meaning of showing where the etheric magnetic energies flow from the hand, as described by Furs Morrish. And I think within my prior videos I may have talked about the notion of Masonic handshakes being used to transfer etheric magnetic energies. And the various shakes do it in various ways. And the further hand signals and arm signals, etc., and use of the feet would be means of communication, I would suggest, within the further dimensions, as strange as this all sounds. Now, Freemason Keith King made a film about Harry Potter. I've not read Harry Potter or seen the entire films myself, but I've watched Keith King's presentation. And I noticed within Keith King's presentation, there was a shot there, and it's showing that etheric magnetic energy, I would suggest. So anyway, let's have a look at that scene right now. I know that Harry Potter is extremely occult, and further within the Harry Potter film, from one of these films that I've seen within Keith King's presentation, we can see this scene where you have a classroom and they're giving esoteric teachings in here, in this classroom, and around the classroom, one of the aspects here is that you have the cages there, like bird cages, and I would suggest that they are representative of the magic ritual edifice, just as we can see in no less than Angel Place in Sydney. But let's get back to the Bible. Actually, screw it. There's so much in the Bible that relates to my work that I can't cover it. It's up to people to read and research. Just within here, you have the reference to the face of the man, the face of the lion, the face of the bull, the ox, and then also the face of the eagle there. Four fixed signs of the zodiac, of course. And then further down here we have, as for the likeness of the living creatures, their appearance was like burning coals of fire and the appearance of lamps. So various things in here, and you can see a reference to the appearance of a flash of lightning, also referring to creatures. Further down here, there's just all sorts in here, wheels, and further down here we have a reference to crystal and so forth. It's jam-packed, but let's make our way, and remember the crystal bit, let's make our way to Washington DC. Okay, America. Within America, you have the state of Virginia and the state of Maryland. Virginia, Maryland, Virgin Mary. And formed out of these two states originally is the District of Columbia. Columbia, within Columbia, you would have Kulum, which would refer, I would suggest, to the dove. The French word for dove is Kulum. It would also perhaps refer to the pillar. The column, the pillar. It's kind of cute to think of the District of Columbia being born out of the Virgin Mary too, where you would have Jesus being born of the Virgin Mary, and indeed Jesus would be imbued with the Holy Spirit, which I would suggest is Mary. For in the Bible we can read many things, but for one we can read, and this refers to Mary, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost, which is the Holy Spirit. And I think it's ridiculous to have a Trinity without the female figure. I just find it absurd. And if we look back through time, we can see female entities like Venus, Kulum, aligned with the dove. And going right back to Semiramis of Babylon, it would seem, being aligned with the dove, and her and the dove being one and the same, and being part of the Trinity, so to speak, the Holy Trinity that's represented here, there, and everywhere. Not far from the District of Columbia in Virginia, if we go to the late Freemason George Washington's house there, we can see atop that house the dove in the weather vane there with the four directions below it. And you would have the Axis Mundi going through the center of that house there esoterically. So let's head to the Capitol building in the District of Columbia. Now, first up, I don't want to get too caught up in the names of God and goddesses here. When we go to the front, the eastern frontal portico of the Capitol building, there are two statues. Now, they represent war and peace. One would be Ceres, the goddess of peace and the goddess of agriculture. And then the other one would be Mars, representing war. War and peace represented there. Now the goddess of peace, Ceres, would sit to the right side of the Columbus doors, and the right side would perhaps represent the right hand of friendship, or the right hand of fellowship, as I think it is in the Bible. Now the god and goddess Ceres and Mars, this is very Roman. These are Roman gods, so there's a real Roman feel to the Capitol building. If we now look to the statue atop the Capitol building, it's the Statue of Freedom. And there are many aspects to the statue. Overall, I would say that it maintains the Roman feel and the notion of war and peace. She has the sheathed sword in the right hand of fellowship or friendship, and she has the laurel wreath and the shield in the left hand. The shield, by the way, as well as the sword, I would deeply suspect have further relevance within the further dimensions, and that would account for that laurel wreath of victory also. The laurel wreath can be made of olive leaves also, and I note that they are often presented by angels, and that's where I think the inspiration perhaps comes from with those. The shield perhaps represents a kind of magical shield also, an etheric one, I would suspect. The goddess here looks out to the east, looks out to the rising sun. She looks away from the obelisk. She looks out to the rising sun, perhaps the morning star Venus, Sirius, etc., etc. Atop her head is the eagle. Above the eagle is a plume. The plume is interesting. Maybe it has something to do with the phoenix. Who knows? The many connotations with the eagle. They're both positioned on the axis mundi that would run through that building. And we'll just go down to the floor below for a second, right down, and you would have the dot on the floor there, representative of the etheric portal way that goes right through, and then down into the crypt of that building, and there would be the etheric portal way represented there also as the sun well. Indeed, in the top of the dome, you would have the sun represented there also. And within the apotheosis of Washington, you would have representation of the various gods there, of the planets and so forth. And you would have the eagle within there also, with the olive branches, which tie in with the dove. And then down to the ground level, you would have the people with pillars around the outside there. To the western side of the Capitol building, you have a fountain there, and that fountain, excuse the pun, would dovetail with the well, I would suggest. And this is mentioned in text to do with the Bethesda fountain, where they liken the well with the fountain, which I think is very appropriate. As this goddess embraces both peace and war, and she's Romanesque, she could perhaps sort of hark back to other deities from that period. She could be sort of influenced by them, with those stars up there, the pentagrams, perhaps Venus. You also have Venus Victrix, which is an aspect of Venus also. Now, interestingly, there's the goddess Minerva, and part of the symbology that goes with her is the owl. And of course, if we look down on the Capitol building, we would have the owl represented there on the ground. And that owl would have central to it, I would suggest, the axis mundi that runs through this very statue at the top that also has the eagle there. So these birds are kind of flying through that axis mundi, if you will, flying through that portal way. And indeed, you can see great representations of this, especially with the dove flying along the light portal way. And then prior to this, if we go back, this goddess perhaps incorporates Semiramis as well, of Babylon. But then again, we could think of her as the goddess Columbia. And indeed, if we look to the Columbia pictures, we can see the goddess there holding up the torch of Gnosis, which perhaps refers to the further unseen light, the further dimensions. Getting back to the notion of that etheric pillar running through the Capitol building, indeed, here is a design concept for a new Capitol building, and they've actually put the pillar in the center there, but it's physical rather than symbolized by other means. Indeed, that central pillar is beautifully symbolized at the Lotus Temple in Yeovilville, Virginia, and it flows right down onto the lotus petals on the altar. In Armenia, they have a war memorial there, and on a postage stamp released by the post office of that country, you have the representation of the physical war memorial plus the physical war memorial with the etheric magnetic beam of light, the pillar, the portal way that runs through the middle of that. And of course, most people would not realize that it's symbolized and that it should be there. Indeed, in Canberra, you have the Parliament building there for Australia, and the ABC Broadcasting Company, who runs under the frequency of 666, by the way, in Canberra, have represented on one of their programs, Capitol Hill, the central etheric beam on their artwork for that program. Now, we've talked about places of power, particularly Washington. Let's just head to the EU for a moment, to France. In France, we have the European Parliament building. Now, there is an organization called the Council of Europe, and it walks like a duck and it quacks like a duck when it comes to the Council of Europe versus the EU. Indeed, they have virtually the same flag or very similar, and they even have the same anthem. Now, the Council of Europe produced this piece of artwork, and it definitely refers to the artwork by Peter Bruegel with his painting of the Tower of Babel. And indeed, the European Parliament building is definitely stylized over Peter Bruegel's portrayal of the Tower of Babel. At the European Parliament building, there is a statue of a bull and a goddess on the bull. Now, the goddess may relate to Europa and the bull may relate to Zeus. But certainly this may go back to Semiramis and Nimrod of Babylon, the Tower of Babel. Now, before we depart from Europe, let's have a look at some of the imagery on this $100 note, where we can see the 12 stars representing the zodiac, I would suggest. And we can see that with the squares, we can see the four around the one. And I would suggest that there is the imagery there of the all-seeing eye. We also have a portal way there with the pillars of Jachin and Boaz. And yes, we have two figures there breaking out of the pillars, if you will. Now, isn't this all built of stone? How can they be sort of breaking out of the stone? I would suggest that if we look further, this is Masonic imagery represented on this note here. Let's get back to America and let's have a look around Washington DC now. So you have the Pentagon, of course, in Virginia, and you also have the Pentagon City, and you have Crystal City also. I would suggest this is a very occult name. If we jump across to Maryland, we have Bethesda there, butting right up against Washington DC. And of course you have Bethesda within Jerusalem, and Mary is said to have been born there by some, this is alleged. Did the actual Mary really exist at all? Jesus, the main character, was perhaps one of the bloodline families, and the whole narrative of the Bible was built around one character like that. The repeated story of old, renewed and revised. But beyond that, I find it just interesting that you have Bethesda within Maryland, the two together right there. And just briefly, within Bethesda, there's an obelisk there, and it's within the lotus and the all-seeing eye. It's the axis mundi, etc. The obelisk has the symbolism of the four elements around it, with the colors, with the lights. But now let's get back to Central Park and to the Bethesda Terrace. This is the original photograph that I came across, and yes, in the foreground you have the four around the one there. And I was looking at it and trying to make out whether there is a mage depicted in the middle or not, in the center, within the kind of plate that's there. Now, whether there is or not, it's not a big deal. I certainly know this is represented with the Freemason Francis Greenway in the center in Sydney, but I'm not local to New York, so I can't sort of travel there and have a look for myself. So I'm trying to find a photograph on the internet, and I just haven't been able to find the right one. But while I was doing this, I came across people blowing bubbles there. It's like a great bubble spot for people blowing bubbles. And I thought, well, yeah, you know, that acts as a kind of etheric shell, if you will. And I thought, what an appropriate place to blow bubbles. But of course, they keep putting their bucket in the center there. So with the photographs that are taken, I can't see that plate. But it's not a big deal. I also came across an illustration from Marvel that shows the dome there. It's perhaps not in the exact spot, but I just found it incredible that whether this was an orb coming down or a big bubble coming down or whatever it was within this Marvel production. But to me, it's just amazing to find this illustration with the etheric dome. And of course, I've got about Sydney with the one with Francis Greenway and said, look, put an etheric dome over this thing. This is part of what is here. But here you can see it kind of laid out before us. This is pretty much it. I'm just going to ramble for a bit. My videos are not really suited, I would suggest, to people who take a mainstream view of the Bible, Quran, Torah, etc. From my point of view, I think there's a lot more going on in the world. I think that there is a reality to the magic aspect, that it's practiced by people high up within secretive societies and the so-called bloodline families and people who kind of run the world in a way. And it's certainly depicted here, there, and everywhere. If you have the eyes to see it and recognize the symbolism, I would suggest. Along the lines of the Bible, etc., the Quran, who really believes that they have an unmanipulated word of God handed to the public? I don't see that sort of thing happening in the world today, and I certainly don't think it was happening in the world 2,000 years ago, 1,500 years ago, 4,000 years ago, you name it. I would like to say that there's lots of positive things in life to do and enjoy, and that doing the right thing unto others is something we all need to try and do in our lives. None of us are perfect, but if we can just do those things, I think, you know, that's the main thing in life. And you know, do things you enjoy and all the rest of it. And yeah, there are problems in the world. There always have been. But if you really believe you have the word of God and it's unfettered and all the rest of it, and you look at the people in power and you, how did that happen? Really? Anyway, I'll leave it at that. All the best, everybody. I really hope you've enjoyed the video, found the information interesting, and bye for now.